Hey everyone, it's Dr. Joyce Park, board certified dermatologist, and I'm back today to talk about a topic that I frankly got wrong last week. I made a TikTok last week about how to preserve your color treated hair, how to make your dye job last longer. And one of the things I said was using a sulfate-free shampoo. This is something we hear all the time on social media and something I learned in residency. However, it was quickly pointed out to me by several cosmetic chemists that the issue is not so black and white. Using sulfate-free products alone is not going to guarantee color preservation of your dye job. So then I went into this really deep rabbit hole and read a ton of literature, looked up studies, and oh my gosh, my mind was blown. There is way more to the story than meets the eye, and the truth is not so black and white. So in today's video, I want to talk about whether or not sulfate-free shampoos is just simply a marketing gimmick, or is there any truth to this matter? And also tackle how really do we manage to preserve the color of our hair and make our dye jobs last longer. So let's talk about how shampoos do their job of cleansing. Let's talk a little bit more about surfactants. Surfactants, the word, actually derives from surface active cleansers. And surfactants usually take the form of a hydrophilic or water-loving head and then an oil-soluble or water-hating hydrophobic tail. And when you have all of these surfactants in water, they work to basically decrease the surface tension of the water. And then they start to form these little balls called micelles. So micelles are essentially balls of surfactants. And they form these balls with all the hydrophilic or water-loving heads on the outside and then the oil-loving, oil-soluble tails on the inside, and then that's where your oil gets trapped, like from your scalp or your skin or whatever you're trying to wash off. That gets trapped in the middle, and then all of these can then be rinsed away by water. Because we know that oil is not technically soluble in water, by forming micelles, this is how we can use detergents and soaps and things like that to actually wash the oil away. Surfactants can come in a whole host of flavors depending on its charge. You can have your anionic, negatively charged surfactants, your cationic, your positively charged surfactants, you can have non-ionic surfactants, and you can have amphoteric surfactants. And they all work together in a system, and that system determines your overall formulation of your shampoo. In recent years, a particular surfactant, a particular anionic surfactant, has gotten a really bad reputation, and that one is one you've probably heard of, which is SLS, or sodium lauryl sulfate, or its cousin, sodium laureth sulfate. I also previously bought into this misconception that sulfate-free shampoos are better for your hair. But as I mentioned before, the research on this is actually conflicting. So SLS, as I mentioned, is an anionic surfactant with that negative charge. And some studies have shown that that negative charge can increase friction as well as potential frizziness of the hair. And some studies have even shown that this can damage the hair cuticle, but that really depends on the concentration of SLS as well as the charge density. But all of the research that I read has basically said that sulfate-free shampoos are not necessarily going to be better for your hair health, because knowing whether or not a shampoo is good does not simply depend on whether or not there are sulfates in it. Speaking more specifically about color loss, so leaching of color from your hair, one study was done where the hair was washed with 100% strength shampoo with the normal level of SLS, and the other group was washed with 50% SLS, and then the control group was washed with straight up water. They surprising to me at least, found that all three groups had similar levels of color leaching. And what does that really tell us? It says that it's not the shampoo itself or the ingredients within the shampoo that's causing the color leaching, but rather repeated exposure to water. I know, water. Water seems like the most innocuous, it's everywhere. Why would that be the thing that's really damaging to our hair? Well, it turns out that water actually causes your hair to swell, which makes it more porous, leading to quicker fading of your color. So now that we know that sulfate-free shampoos don't guarantee color preservation of your dye job, what can we really do to lengthen our color? It turns out that hair habits play a much bigger role in your hair color. I'll give you now a couple of tips that were shared to me by my friend Valerie, who is a cosmetic chemist who formulates hair products day in and day out. Number one, we know that UV from the sun is not only bad for your skin, but it can also change change and damage the color of your hair. So it's really important that you do some type of protection from UV rays. And this can be in the form of a hat, or it can be in the form of a spray. I've seen several hairsprays or even dry shampoos that actually contain UV protectant within them. Secondly, we know that heat exposure can actually damage your hair as well. Whenever you're using your curling iron or using your flat iron or any other hot tools, you definitely want to spray some type of heat protectant on first. Secondly, it's really important to minimize exposure to water. Now, we talked about this. Water is the major culprit in losing your color after you leave the salon. Ways to do this are to wash your hair less frequently. I know, you're thinking, oh my gosh, I have oily scalp, what do I do? Basically, you wanna use dry shampoo to help extend the time in between washes. And when you go to the beach or if you're going to the pool, wear a swim cap so that you're minimizing your exposure to that water as well. And one interesting point that someone had commented on my TikTok when I posted this was, what about air drying versus blow drying your hair right away? Because if you're air drying, your hair is actually being exposed to a lot of water as it dries. And turns out there's actually a study that was done in Korea that looks at this very issue. Researchers in South Korea allowed hair to either dry naturally through air drying or allowed it to dry through being blow dried at various temperatures, ranging from very low temperature to very hot temperature. And then afterwards, they took those hair strands and then they analyzed them under electron microscopy. And the results were pretty interesting. They basically found cell membrane complex damage only in the group that had been air dried. And they hypothesized that this was due to prolonged exposure to water during that air drying process, which allowed the hair to actually swell. They also found increasing evidence of damage to the hairs as the temperature of the blow dryer was increased. They basically came up with best practices for how to dry your hair. They recommended that the ideal way to dry your hair after a shower is actually to squeeze out all of the excess water from your hair and then use a blow dryer, but hold it 15 centimeters away from your hair and then operate it with continuous motion so that it's never staying on one section of hair for very long. They said that that's better for color preservation and also just to preserve strength and health of your hair rather than air drying it or blow drying it at very high temperatures. This study was also mind-blowing to me because I, being very lazy, I always air dry my hair. And I always thought for the longest time, well, maybe this is an excuse I made. I said, I'm not gonna blow dry my hair because then I'm exposing it to more heat and I know heat is bad for the hair and for preserving my color. But it turns out that prolonged water exposure is just as bad, if not worse, for the hair. So in this case, you kind of have to pick and choose, right? Because we know that prolonged water exposure is bad, but high heat is also bad. So my main takeaway from this study is, you know what? I actually will make sure to squeeze out all the excess water from my hair, and then I will try to blow dry, but at the lowest temperature setting, and keep the blow dryer continuously moving and hold it a little bit away from my actual hair. So hopefully this video didn't leave you even more confused. I'm going to just break down for you who could actually benefit from a sulfate cleanser, a sulfate-free cleanser, and what the heck do you do if you have color-treated hair. Those who could benefit from a sulfate-containing shampoo are people who have more oily scalps, people who might enjoy a deeper cleanse because these surfactants do deliver a deeper, more thorough type of cleanse, and also people who want that foaming sensation. People with fine hair may also benefit from using a sulfate shampoo. Now, who can benefit from a sulfate-free shampoo? It could be people with medical conditions in the scalp that have very sensitive skin on their scalps. For example, eczema, ichthyosis, allergy-prone scalps. These might potentially get irritated by sulfates, so I would recommend that they steer clear and that they opt for the sulfate-free shampoo. And also because sulfates can cause some more dryness of the hair, we do recommend that people with curly hair or brittle hair or coarse hair can benefit from also picking sulfate-free shampoos too. If you have color-treated hair, you can choose sulfates or sulfate-free shampoos. We now know that that doesn't really have a big impact on your color preservation. However, the words she said to look for, my friend who's a cosmetic chemist, included gentle, low foaming, and color safe. She mentioned that the words color safe means that the hair company has done some sort of testing against a control. They've tested this shampoo against some type of control, whether it's water or a certain percentage of SLS, and their shampoo came out better for color preservation. So at the very least, you know that it's been tested. And she also mentioned if all else fails, look for an ingredient in the ingredient list called amodimethicone, but she said that is a true hero ingredient for preserving color. So at the end of the day, it really comes down to personal preference. Do you want sulfate shampoo? Do you want sulfate-free shampoo? It comes down to preference, what your your scalp needs are, what your hair needs are, and really what you prefer. So I hope this video has been helpful in busting the myth around sulfate versus sulfate-free shampoo. And I hope I also shed a little bit more light about how to preserve the color in your hair, because God knows we spend a lot of money getting this balayage, and you don't want all that money to go to waste in just a few short months after your trip to the salon. As always, if you have any questions, feel free to drop them below. Don't forget to hit subscribe, because we have new video content coming out every single week about your skin, hair, and your nails. And I'm always open to talking about new topics that you are interested in. Until next time, bye.